So it's now time to kick off. We start today with a presentation from our CEO and founder of Moodle, Martin Dougiamas, who will speak to about where we can take Moodle next. Please welcome to the stage, Martin Dougiamas.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you, Paul. Not only is he a good-looking MC, he is also the product manager of MoodleNet. Hi. Good morning, everybody. You know, this, wow, look at this. This is the biggest moot ever. So let's have a cheer for that. Welcome back. After the after Thanos clicked fingers and we all disappeared for 3 years, it's so good to be back. I'm going to talk today very broadly. That's why I've put here the big gist. I really want to go large with the context of what we're doing, but those of you who have seen me before. This is how my keynotes usually start. They'll start with a mission, empowering educators to improve the world with the most effective platform for learning. I'll talk about the Moodle values, education, openness, respect, integrity, innovation, and how we're a certified B Corp and all that. I might talk about the conference. We have 840 Moodlers. 840 of us have come together here. We have 120 from Moodle headquarters. That is amazing. Last week, we all had a get-together ourselves in Sitges. It's just down the road, about half an hour drive. And we did a lot of brainstorming together, and it was amazing. So there's 120 of the people who make Moodle here, plus the rest of you who make Moodle here. It's going to be great. I really like this number. We had only half of the sessions that were proposed that we could accept. We had twice as many. And 22 sponsors. Thank you to all the sponsors. They're all around. You'll see them. We're from 60 countries and 113 talks overall. It's going to be massive. Moodle HQ are now 178 people, soon 248. Can't tell you how. We're all over the place. Moodle itself is everywhere, I would say, if this was a normal keynote. We have more Moodle partners than ever. We have new certified integrations. We have all this activity going on in products, but I'm not even going to talk about that today because the rest of the team are here to talk about that, and there's like 3 days of it. So there's, you know, this, you'll see everything around the venue and all the sessions. By the way, you like this hotel? It's pretty nice, huh? We're all in a spaceship today. Get around the spaceship and talk to everyone about this stuff. One thing I will highlight, we are Moodle Workplace 4.0 finally released this week. So there'll be a lot on that if you want to get into it. So yeah, thanks. If you aren't on Matrix yet, come join us in the Matrix. We are using Matrix for Moodle community chat from now on. And there is some chat rooms there. So this isn't—it's not WhatsApp, it's not Telegram, it's not Facebook Messenger, it's not Microsoft Teams, it's not Slack, it's not any of those. It's an open system like Moodle that we will be integrating with in the future. And there's the QR code to take you to some instructions. After you do that, you will join us in the Matrix. This conference is all great news, so go and see all that. So I'm not going to talk about all of that. I'm going to talk about our history. Who knows what that is? Anybody? Yell it out. Sorry? A cell. That is one cell. It's actually a mammalian cell in a mammal. Quite interesting and complex. Cells first emerged at least 3.8 billion years ago, about 750 million years after Earth was formed. That picture in the background is not a photograph. I've generated that with an AI. Almost all of this presentation has been generated with an artificial intelligence. So I've been using an AI in a number of ways to generate some of this content and a lot of the images. Cells came together into multicellular organisms around 1.7 billion years ago. This is all of our shared history I'm talking about here. First animals, and animals comes from the Latin, anima, movement, you know, animals, things that could move around, around 600 million years ago. Very tiny creatures, little worms. The first humans started emerging around 2 million years ago. The first modern humans, Homo sapiens, is only 200,000 years ago. Now you start seeing where the AI gets pictures a little bit weird sometimes, but I actually like the weirdness of AI imagery. Sometimes it's funny, sometimes it's weird, sometimes it makes you think. So each one of us is a community of around 100 trillion cells that work together. That's what makes up each of our bodies, and they're being constantly renewed. This is one type of communication between cells, between two neurons in your brain. Each one is a cell, and there's electrical signals. So that's, you may have heard about that. But there are, in fact, around 22 or 23 different types of communication that happen between cells. All types of chemical and physical and electrical signals that happen. This one was not from an AI. I don't want to put too many lies on slides. But this one was. I got a picture of it. I think it looks arguably more artistic. So in our brain, we have 85 billion neurons. There are more connections between the cells in your brain, each one of us, than stars in the universe. We have a ton of these cells working together in each of our brains. All of that is working together right now. So I'm standing here, 100 trillion cells. That's me trying to generate a picture of a speaker on a stage. Those cells are all working together right now. Each cell in my body is pumping out signals. It doesn't even know where the signals are going. Each cell is pumping out electricity and chemical and physical cell communication outside itself, and that's letting all of this happen in front of you right now that we're all used to. So the cells over this an immense period of time have worked out how to come together into an organization that can get things done. I would like you all now, close your eyes, and just feel your 100 trillion cells. So just clear your mind a little bit. And just feel that collection of cells, that is your body, working together. And now, feel yourself in the space. Open your eyes. Look to the person next to you. That person next to you is another 100 trillion cells like you. Now what we are the universe looking at itself. Right? We are not separate from the universe. Has anybody heard of the philosopher Alan Watts? Anyone know Alan Watts? He was pretty big in the 60s. A couple of people here. Alan Watts talks about the idea that like a tree, an apple tree, apples, the earth has peopled. So we're like fruit that's sort of come out of the earth. And the way cells have come together and formed life, it formed us. So moving on, we Homo sapiens did rather well against the, there was a few other variants of humans at the time, the Neanderthals and Homo erectus. We moved out of Africa across the world. These are the years you can see, roughly how long ago we got to different parts of the planet. And we did kill a lot of the Neanderthals and Homo erectus in battles, but we also absorbed them. In our genes are a lot of genes from those other variants of human. We were able actually to crossbreed. But we kind of wiped them out and we became a more single species. So about 2,500 years ago, and this is a funny picture if you look at it too closely, I was just in Greece, actually, and I had the honor of accepting an honorary doctorate from the University of Piraeus. And it was a very big deal for me because I'm half Greek and because I was in the birthplace of education. This is Plato founded the very first school or university, all right? The academy, the first academy, academia. It's called academia, not because it was like the area of Athens where he made it. That's where academy comes from. But Plato also did a lot of work and conceptualizing how humans could work together in harmoniousness, how we could come together in a society. And he's not the only one. Lots of people have done it since, but that was one of the earliest attempts at sort of saying, okay, how can all these people work together in better ways? 250 years ago, an industrial revolution, we became less just farmers and taking advantage of our environment and much more building and creating machines to do more of our work. 80 years ago, the very first programmable computers. Charles Babbage made some calculators. I don't really count them as full computers. So we're talking about the first real computers around the Second World War. That's not a real picture, remember. These are all AI generated, so they're a little off, but they are copyright free. This one is a real picture, because that's a very historical moment. This is 50 years ago we started the internet. A bunch of total nerds figured out how to send words and letters across wires in a way that they could, and they were on the phone at the same time typing L. Did you get the L? and they were, I think L-O-G were the first letters they sent. Around the 50s, also we had the artificial intelligence. So we started working on chess playing machines and things like that. A lot of you may remember in the 80s and 90s and 2000s, the machine learning that was starting to come up. And honestly, I discounted a lot of it. I was like, it's not even interesting to me because it was very algorithmic, very boring, nothing like 85 billion cells working together at all. Very, very simplistic. But it was starting to get quite good at sorting your mail into mailboxes and things like that. In the last couple of decades, we've moved into an era of deep learning. And this is where AI is starting to really become interesting. You may remember about 11 years ago, also not AI, that it was an IBM, had an AI that won Jeopardy, the US game show, against two of the best players in history. About 6 years ago, Google DeepMind AI beat the world's best Go player. And Go was always seen as this very, very, very hard problem to solve. And the way it did it was they trained the AI looking at a lot of humans playing Go, and then they made that AI play itself. And that kind of self-training is a really interesting thing, where our machines can train themselves to do things by playing against themselves. Two months ago, AlphaFold, another project, solved the protein folding problem. This is a very important thing to solve when developing drugs and therapies, to know how long strings of proteins fold up into a shape. Because once you know the shape, you can develop drugs and all kinds of things. People would spend their whole life solving one of these things. It'd be like your PhD project, and then you'd spend 10 or 20 years in research trying to solve these shapes of proteins. One AI solved 200 million proteins in one go, and they open sourced it all. Basically, every known living protein is now no longer an issue. That was like a month ago. So now we have AIs that can write and understand computer code. A lot of developers are using AIs to write 30%, 40%, 50% of all their code, and it's getting higher. They can understand and transcribe any speech. There was one released last week called Whisper, which is one of the best voice recognition systems I've ever seen. It's better than anything on our phones right now. It can understand really rough, messy human text and just flawlessly understand it. We can create text, we can create, understand images. Remember, this is another AI, all AI images in the background. And we can create and design nearly anything. So there are new systems appearing daily right now. Let me show you a couple very quickly. Has anybody not seen how AI imagery is generated before? Can I have some hands? You've not actually seen it? Okay, there's not many of you anymore, so that's good. But I'll do it very quickly. So I won't do a bird in a funny hat, but I don't know, yell out a couple of words. I just want some words and I'll make something new. Bread. What? Bread. Bread? You're hungry. Bread. And another word, and I'll combine them. Sorry? Santa. Okay, let's have Santa holding, let's have Santa. Santa made from bread. I'll do it without any special things. We'll just put it straight in. Let's see what happens. Now, I'm doing this on a website, so it's using a server to do this, which is not so impressive because you go, well, I could just use Google search. I'd probably find something, let's see how it works out. Oh, well, there's Santa and some bread. But what I could also do is this. This is Stable Diffusion, which is the same AI, running on my laptop, 100% on my laptop. I can switch off my Wi-Fi, and I could do the same thing. I can generate. Santa. Let's say holding a loaf of bread. So it is a bit mind-boggling that I'm able to download a brain, an electronic brain, that can conceptualize almost anything I can imagine, and that is all sitting on this M1 laptop. It's not even the M2 yet, it's just an M1, and it ran that fast. It takes a bit longer if I want bigger or higher resolution, but any image. Think how many images there could be. I need, let's see here. I had here great ways to use Moodle. Let's just generate a bit of text here. Write a poem about how much Santa loves bread. Not Satan. Santa loves bread. He loves the smell, the taste, the way it feels in his hands. He loves to tear off a chunk and savor the flavor of fresh, warm bread. Santa loves bread so much that he eats it every day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. He even takes a loaf with him on his sleigh ride around the world to share with all the good girls and boys. So if you're feeling hungry this holiday season, just ask Santa for a slice of bread. He'll be more than happy to oblige. Quite a nice little poem. It also explains, his high-carb diet explains a lot as well. But that's, you know, this is normal stuff now in AI. A lot of you are in education and you probably ask your students to submit essays, assignments, projects. Any student can use these. Both of these tools are completely free with no waiting list, and you can just get in and do it. And everyone is building new tools on top of this stuff weekly. The T-shirt that you got for the moot, I hope you got your T-shirt, has this image on it, which I generated a couple of months ago. It's already looking very simplistic because of the state of the art and how fast this stuff is moving. But that's the prompt that I used to generate that. The Trencadis mosaic is a style of mosaic art from around Barcelona, around Catalonia. And one of our team suggested it. And I thought, oh, it'd be nice to have an earth globe made of that orange. You know, it's the Moodle Global. And so we came up with that T-shirt. And I thought, good to put it on the T-shirt, just to remember this point in history, because this is the year that this stuff is all going mainstream. So that's why that's there. Now, meanwhile, this is going on. This is our population. All these 100 trillion cell packages, a lot of you in this room will remember when we were back at 3 billion, and now we're nearly 8 billion. The projections are that we're going to hit around 11 billion, and then it will actually level off. And the reason is the pink line is showing our the birth rate, which, and most people will say the reason our birth rate is declining, or the growth is declining, is because of education. Education leads to more families being involved in the economy, working, having less children. And as the world becomes more educated, this is plummeting. So we're actually tailing off. It's very interesting to think about that whole process and where we're heading. Elon Musk is super worried about it, and I think that's why he has so many children. But he can probably afford it. All these people in the world are gathering together into organizations. All these organisms are becoming organizations. They are the new creatures that walk the planet Earth, the organizations that we build. And, you know, Moodle is one organization. All of your institutions and companies are all organizations. We've got the bigger ones and the smaller ones. And we're a huge ecosystem of, just like our cells came together, the humans are coming together into these organizations. And they're all shapes and sizes and colors. Some of them not so nice. Some of them a little too focused on profit, generating money at all cost. We have, you know, the big pharma, the big oil, the Monsantos, that have sort of gone a bit crazy wild about money, and they're actually causing problems for us. There are a mixture, just in any ecosystem, there's a real mixture of types of organizations that we are putting together. And these organizations, as they stride the earth are working on systems to connect us even more. So Moodle software, one example, not that little anymore, but think of all of the infrastructure being put into place by organizations. All of the, obviously, roads and shipping and internet and that kind of stuff, but also all of the cultural connections, all of the art, the memes, the ideas, the structures that we are putting into place. Think of what you spend most of your time probably doing every day. You're probably looking into one of these machines and connecting with a ton of activity that's out there. And all of that is just electrons. It seems like electrons, but you're connecting to other people's brains through electrons, and we're wiring up the world. We're connecting up the world. It's like fungus, you know, mycelium. Anyone familiar with how much fungus there is in the world? There's a great documentary called about fungi. I like to be a fungi sometimes. But this stuff under the surface of the earth, all around us, is these strands of fungus that are actually connecting up all the trees, a lot of the plants. The plants actually use that to communicate with each other, like an internet for plants. It's amazing. So we're connecting up the earth more and more. We're globalizing, and there's this ongoing process, I hope you can see, through history, of us coalescing and connecting. Some of the products we're developing in the more education-related space to connect, wearables, right? The technology is not big computers like the 1940s anymore. It's little things, you know, we're all carrying around these supercomputers, the black mirrors, we're looking through them, we're connecting to everything. Everyone's connecting to us as well. Even if you don't want it, sometimes you have to get very good at managing your notifications because you're being sucked into the fungus. But, you know, headphones, watches, VR is coming, AR, this stuff is coming. It's been talked about for a long time, but really the technology level wasn't there. But look at Facebook, Meta, change the whole company towards that stuff. Apple are releasing headsets next year, and rumors are that they're planning in 10 years that they will replace phones, because we just wear the phone on our face. So even closer connections. There's Mark. These companies and organizations are going to be moving into this space. We're going to be in this space with them. They're going to be superimposing their realities on top of our realities, like they do now. You know, when you look at most things, you see, you know, advertising and corporate effects on everything we're looking at. That's, you know, that's fine. But it's going to be much more visual and much more all the time than ever before. And the quality of the imagery that we receive, as you could see from the AI stuff I was showing before, this is not AI, this is a Unreal Engine 5 rendering. The quality will be indistinguishable from the real stuff. Reality and the internet are going to become so close you can't tell. Just like the AI imagery look like photographs, a lot of it. It won't just be flat photographs. It's not hard to imagine the images I've been showing you extending into, generate me an 18-hour TV series about this character and this character and that character, and they're all doing this, you know, and you get your favorite TV show coming forever. My wife really likes Brooklyn Nine-Nine, and it ran out at like 8 seasons. Probably wished I could I have 2 more seasons? Well, I just feed the 8 seasons in and generate another 2 seasons of endless comedy, right? then think, well, expand that to virtual reality. You know, oh, I want to generate a new reality. I could, instead of typing Santa with a piece of bread, I could say, generate Santa walking around with a piece of bread. And you've all got your glasses on and you can see him too. And he walks around handing out bread to everybody. That seems very, very achievable to me. It doesn't seem very far away at all. Of course, we can overdo it with the devices. That's a pretty weird picture when you look at it too long. Look at the hand. Wow. So we're in this world. We have to need to think about the ethics, the truth. You know, are we all slipping into this fake-generated AI-generated place that's influenced? Because a lot of us don't know how to make this technology. We're reliant on the people we're connected to bring it to us. And what I worry about is that the world agenda, which is this, the sustainable development goals, they're not perfect, but this is the only roadmap for humanity that humanity has ever made recently. Maybe Plato had one, but more recently, UNESCO, which is every country on Earth, agreed on this. This is not like an idea, why don't we do it? This is, oh yeah, everyone's already agreed. Our governments have already agreed. This is the agenda. Except the US, because US is not part of UNESCO. But the rest of the world, the other 95% have. And I don't want to call that US, it's not your fault who's in the room, but that's just the fact. So here we have huge problems. Poverty, we have increasing inequality, we have climate change to worry about, we have so many problems in the land, in the oceans, in this little planet that we live on, that how can we focus on that if we're all being our same 85 billion neurons from 200,000 years ago, which hasn't changed? If that is in this world of hyper-stimulation that I'm talking about and connection, how do we get everybody to work together and focus on life-threatening things like this? And that's my main worry. That's what keeps me up at night. This was an alternate T-shirt that I almost had for the moot. I do like this cow. I just stuck it in here because I wanted to show you this cute cow. I actually generated that by typing in the word Moodle into an AI, and I got that. So our education needs to step up to prepare us for this world. This is the world we have been rushing towards for this long period and accelerating now in a hyper-growth way, and it's coming at us so fast. Education needs to adapt to this world like now, like ASAP. Now, I typed in something about strength and something, trying to show a strong education system, and I got this. I do not recommend education is this, but it was such a funny picture, I had to keep it. I just love it. Yeah, but you know, this is like education going, yeah, we're going to solve this problem, I hope. Now, to do that, we need an infrastructure that it can enable us to work together better. Because right now, and I was in the University of Piraeus, and I don't want to call them out as any different from any other university, but what happens at universities, in general, is the way the system is structured, there is some working together. There are like EU projects, and there's funding that tries to make people work together. And academics with a lot of experience sit down and get into problems, and they write papers, and they push the papers out into the journals, and their peer review in journals, and we have this whole research system to generate and share knowledge, and that's very good. And companies will draw from that to produce products, and that's kind of how we do things. But there's no overarching framework there. There's a lot of niches, a lot of little holes that go on, and it's kind of, And I talked to one academic, and I was like, he's working on optimizing Wi-Fi in a city, for example. And I was like, that's fascinating. When can we see it? He goes, oh, I don't know. I'm just writing the paper. I'm putting it out there. You know, maybe, you know, Huawei or something will come along and use it. I don't feel like we've optimized how education works together. I feel like universities should be like more entrepreneurial than startups. Like the university, the students at that university should be hacking the Wi-Fi of that university. They should be hacking the energy system of that university. They should be solving inequality in that university. And as a hub of innovation that's pouring out of these universities and places that we can then share. There are over 90,000 higher education institutions in the world. And growing, mostly growing in the global south, apparently, in the private area, which is interesting. But it doesn't matter, there's a lot of them. Imagine if all these institutions worked together on something. Imagine the resources we would have. There would be like the biggest startup ever. Now, the only way I know that works together, my criteria for how we work together on things like technology, is what has worked for Moodle. That's why we're all here. The last 20 years, these are kind of my principles for developing open education technology, or edtech in general. Number one, open source all the main stuff. Open sourcing the software enables innovation, enables... In this room, there are so many people who have created such amazing things, and you can go and all see each other over the next 3 days. Second, you have to listen to educators. And that's, you know, research and UX and all of that. But if we aren't actually addressing education problems, we shouldn't be there. Thirdly, engaging developers. And we have some things coming up that are intended to support our developers even better. We don't expect everyone to work for free. People, you know, we all have to live. So how do we get everybody to be part and making a living also from working on the stuff that we share? And lastly, that's this one, is making things sustainable with revenue. That money is important. We need it to live in this economy. But what we don't want to be doing is pulling too much money out of education and then going, oh, education is not doing very well. It's, you know, it's underfunded and it's weak, and let's replace it with this app. We should be thinking about how we get more money into education and more people employed to work on those education problems in a way that we all share. And so that means you have to make it attractive to people to come and be on board. And look at you all here. Like, I'm so grateful you all came to this MOOC. So that's why you may hear me banging on about open ed tech, which is my attempt to try and define a framework that we can work within to bring together lots of different projects from lots of different institutions and places around the world. And it's bigger than Moodle. You know, we could have called it, you know, Moodle Next Gen and just stopped there, but it's much bigger than that. I think it's a way trying to define a structure that everybody can feel very comfortable in their organization joining and working together. A UN of EdTech. We started this, some of you were here at our Moodle Moot 2019, and afterwards we had a couple of days of brainstorming, and we started the fundamentals of that. And I think most of these people are all here today. If you were here at this meeting, put your hand up. Can I see if you're here? There you go. So we did a lot of great work at that time. The pandemic got in the way and kind of slowed things down a bit, but the association is starting. I think it's waiting on my final signature. I've been away from home for a few weeks. We have to get that going. The association is going to be an actual organization, a non-profit organization based in Brussels. And the point is that everybody who believes in this concept, who supports those criteria I mentioned before, can be a member and work together on a vision, and I'm proposing a very rough vision here to start with, of a new framework. And I'm not going to go into it now because I haven't got time, but I do have a session on Thursday afternoon, a workshop. Is it Wednesday? I forget what day it is. Anyone know? Someone look it up for me. I have a session later on, a workshop. If you're interested in this and want to dive into this a bit more, we have an hour and a half to really get into it. And I can... Oops, I'm cutting out. So we have the idea of there must be open education resource repositories. It must be technology that helps gather and collect all of the great resources that are around. There needs to be educator classrooms in there that the educator owns. And I'm very strong on that point. I don't think institutions should own the classroom. I feel like they're a very personal space. And as an educator, if you really want to be an educator, not a researcher who's being forced to teach for 10% of my time, but an actual educator, then you want to have a space you can develop over decades, right? Not... Currently, a lot of people have PowerPoint slides or something sitting on their hard disk and they upload it into different things. But if you have a real space you can invest yourself into, I think that's going to be far more powerful. And this part is very important, the learner dashboard. The learner needs to also have a space. All of us are learners. Throughout our learning history, which is probably at least 60, 70 years now, who knows, once we AIs start messing with our genetics, it could be hundreds of years. But we need a place to call our own that we can trust and we can invest ourselves into because we own it in this space. It's not sitting on credly.com or some other .com or .org or LinkedIn. It's something you own. And it's your space with AIs that help you move about in the world, help you deal with the world, help you be educated, and help you connect to education opportunities and things. And lastly, also organizations as well. Organizations need a place to manage their learning. Now, we have a lot of activity going on. Already in Moodle, thinking about how Moodle projects might fit into here, but it won't only be Moodle. I think anybody who believes in open ed tech will come up with solutions. It doesn't matter if you pick this one from Moodle and that one from edX or something, or learning economies or whatever. Different organizations can come up with solutions. The key bit is these green arrows, that we have a very tight set of agreed APIs and frameworks and standards that let it all work together into the future. There are working groups happening on openedtech.global. There's a newsletter you can sign up for. It's kind of new. It's starting up. Forgive the mess. Also doing my normal job. But this is our. This is going to be a big part of the future, I think. And we don't have all the details defined because right now we're getting together interested people to define those details. So I'll just finish and say, let's have the best MoodleMoot ever. And in case you're thinking, oh, he's thinking about all this future stuff, what happens with Moodle? I see the current Moodle as being the main platform that we're all working on for the next 5 or 10 years. There's still lots of things we need to do, we are all doing in that platform. But we also need to be aware of kind of the trend, what's coming up in the future, right? Like, where do we go in the future? A PHP application that started 20 years ago, and by the way, there is it's 20 years. Moodle's been around for 20 years. So let's have a round of applause for Moodle for 20 years. I really want to thank you all for being on this Moodle journey, and I just want to kind of energize us to take it to the next level, right? To get to use this enormous amount of people around the world that the Moodle community is to really empower education and improve our world in all the ways that we can. So thank you very much for listening and have a great Moodle Moot.
Thank you, Martin. We have about 5 minutes if there are any questions for Martin. Direct, we have some mics here.
Thanks. Morning, Martin.
Where are you? Hey!
I'm Matabo from University of South Africa. We've been chatting online for a bit.
Yeah, hi, Matabo.
Hi. What are your thoughts around, you've mentioned as you were closing off, 5 to 10 years, it's a PHP application. It's also the foundation of some of the thoughts that you've shared here this morning.
Yes.
Do you see the product evolving away from the current architecture and stack? And where do you see that going? Keeping in mind the future that you've shared.
Yeah, the roadmap of Moodle is something our team are addressing. There are so many sessions about that. There's a lot of exciting things. I mentioned one already, messaging, I think, getting messaging more into Moodle. We're talking about, I don't want to jump ahead of everyone else's presentations. There is a lot that will happen in terms of making Moodle easier, making it more connected with other software. But the general structure of Moodle as a kind of all-in-one learning management platform that is really designed as an analog to a physical institution. You know, its structure is an organization with departments, with classrooms, with activities that happen in the classrooms, with enrollments. You know, it has that structure. And I think Moodle has played a good role in moving people from a face-to-face brick or whatever you tin, whatever you want to use to build your institution, into the internet. Like, a lot of people understand that transition with Moodle. And I think during this past 20 years, that was very necessary. And I think for the next 5 or 10 years, there'll be lots of people still doing that. A lot of people are not even teaching online yet, right? We're still expanding and growing, and there's a lot of that to do. There is a ton of innovation that can still happen on the Moodle platform and connect with things. What I was talking about was really trying to set the scene for some new thing that we would all build together that we would migrate to at some point in the future. And we have to do that, right? We can't just sort of look at next month, and not be aware of all the trends that are happening in the world and how we connect. I think we can add more AI to Moodle next week if we want to. You know, a lot of these things we can still innovate and build into Moodle right now. So yeah, to answer your question, don't worry. And, it's something we're all working on together and we all face exactly the same issues too. So we're not going. There's no big disruption planned. It's more of a, how can we plan for the future?